the purpose of this session is actually I'm actually gonna need your help. That's the reason why I pulled this session together. Because we are formulating the investment strategy for our new fund while we're investing already, so it's a bit sort of late, but we're still sort of doing it. And we see all these amazing developments in technology. I get all these proposals from entrepreneurs who have come up with the next big idea for this and that, or the Uber for this and that. And I want to just make sense of it all. My last count, speaking to one of my colleagues who actually has done the count, we haven't, and there's about 700 Africa-focused technology businesses, startups at the moment that are in seeking funding. And those that only include those that are actually focused on inclusive growth across sort of sub-Saharan Africa. So in order to make sense of that huge pool of potential investments for our fund, I want to understand some of the technology trends a bit better that we see happening right now. So the theme of this session is that we want to talk about what are the technology trends that we think are going to be the most important in the next 5 years in Africa, and how are they really going to change the daily lives of people. And to have a bit of a framework for that conversation, we've picked five trends that we see as potentially the most important for inclusive growth in Africa. And I've written them down there on the board. They're big data, blockchain, on-demand services, cloud computing, and Internet of Things. And what we're most interested in is actually to see also where those trends converge, where the startups that we see, the technology applications and innovations that we see, are the ones that use, that are based on more than just one of these, but on a number of these. And that's where we think the exciting stuff is happening. And so the conversation here today is going to be around what do we see happening in the field? Where do we believe these things are going? And in order to have that conversation, I need your contribution. So this is not going to be a session of talking heads telling you and explaining what the world is like. This is going to be a session where you are going to contribute to the knowledge of the panel. So I hope you're up for the challenge. To just kick it off, I would like the people that we have on the panel to introduce themselves and explain how they fit into that ecosystem, and then also where they... No, actually, we shouldn't do that yet. And then I want to ask you to vote on each of those five and where you believe that most of the innovation is coming from. And then at the end of the session, I want to do that vote again, and then let's see how your opinions have shifted in the course of the session. Okay, does that work for you? Because you're guiding this, so you need to be happy with it. Yes? Okay, cool. I think that's a yes.
Yes.
Okay, good. Eric, can I ask you to introduce yourself?
Oh, well, my name is Eric Osiakwan. From Ghana. I run a fund called Shanzu Capital by day. At night, I'm an angel investor and tech entrepreneur. I've got 10 startups that I've invested in so far. The latest two investments are in logistics and swapping. So if you check out swapaholics.com. So you have a shirt you don't like, you don't want to go buy another shirt. But you know, somebody wants a shoe, you can swap. The other one is a company called Forehead. Four is like an Uber for laundry. So let's imagine you want to wear the shirt you're wearing now tomorrow morning. It's most likely you can't. But imagine you have a nap and then you can tell them, hey, can you pick this up from my hotel tonight and bring it tomorrow at 6 a.m.? That's what they do. by way of introduction, that's basically what I do. We focus on investing in five countries we call the Kings of Africa. So to the topic of the panel, we believe there are five countries that are leading the digital economy in Africa. So
can I let them take a test? My test.
Yeah.
Okay, so we see whether you know those countries. So KINGS is K-I-N-G-S. So what does K stand for? Otherwise they'll kick you out right now. I stands for? Yeah, somebody said Ivy Coast, that's correct. N stands for? G stands for? If you didn't know that, I'll And then S stands for?
Sudan.
So you passed the test, so next question.
Hello, my name is Elizabeth Reese.
Professor. I am filling in for my colleague Stefan, in case you're confused, for Mathri Root, which is a Kenyan-based startup. We are Kenya's leading transportation communication platform. So for those of you who live in Kenya, or in Nairobi, I should say, you probably don't need me to explain that traffic is a problem that plagues the city daily, not just the city, a lot of the country. If you aren't from Nairobi, I would like to say that I hope you can get through the week without experiencing that, but I'd be pretty surprised if you don't spend at least an hour or two here or there sitting in traffic. And that's just one of the issues that we deal with on our crowdsource-based platform that uses mobile applications, a website, and of course social media. We reach about 500,000 people a day through that. Our best known is our Twitter handle, which is Mathiru. And we are currently in Kenya with obvious grand plans to expand. I'll leave it there.
Can you hear us in the back?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Terrific. Hi, my name is Vahid. I'm CEO of Nomanini. Nomanini is a point-of-sale player. We effectively built technology for merchant aggregation with a particular focus on informal retailers. They call them bodegas. In Latin America, they call them baracas. In Mozambique, they call them spaza shops in South Africa. We had a big focus on those points of trade that where the majority of people in Africa get their daily goods and bringing them into the digital world by providing them with a point of sale that can sell airtime, can do mobile money, cash in, cash out, and a bunch of other things for that business. And by my count of those...
No, we're not going to do it.
No? And we do a lot of those things.
All right, so my name is Winnie, and I'm the investment manager for LGT Venture Philanthropy. So LGT stands for Liechtenstein Global Trust.
Do you want a microphone? Because you're
Yeah.
Excuse me.
LGT stands for Liechtenstein Global Trust, and we are impact investors. We are a global fund, and we invest in 4 key regions, that's Southeast Asia, Latin America, Africa, and the UK. We look at 4 key sectors, that's healthcare, education, agribusiness, and renewable energy. So when we are assessing investment opportunities, we look at any financial inclusion opportunity that's able to create impact, so long-term impact. And that's how financial inclusion comes into play when we're assessing opportunities. I'm based here in Nairobi, but we have regional teams globally. Okay.
My name is Meshak. I'm CEO and founder at SEBI. We are a marketplace for logistics, ranging from bikes, pickup trucks, three-ton trucks, currently in Nairobi and Greater Nairobi, and basically looking at also connecting the cities together. And so like in a way that we basically reduce the cost of logistics, both from the cities and to the cities as well.
My name is Hilda. I'm ex-founder of Wizardtelec, which got acquired last year. And I'm still in the fintech space, and I'm feeling in most of that right now. Fintech still excites me, and that's where I am still doing a lot of entrepreneurship stuff. And yeah.
Thank you. Okay. So before we go into this panel discussing these 5 trends, I would actually like to invite you, I think actually, listen, you're a data scientist, right? So maybe you can do the counting.
Okay.
Yes.
So mobile first is not a trend. There's a growing segment of the population that will only experience the internet through mobile device.
I don't think it's even a growing section. I think it's...
Well, It is growing.
It's huge and growing.
Does that not fit on your list?
No, so then I should explain it a bit better. So the understanding is that actually sort of Africa being a mobile-first continent is really given in this conversation.
Okay.
So the mobile revolution has started to unfold in Africa, and that's a given.
Got it.
And what has happened on the back of that is that you would see mobile payments, which are now sort of not at the same level in each country in Africa. It's sort of fair to say that mobile payments have started to happen in Africa. So in terms of projecting where that trend is going to go beyond sort of where it is now is an interesting conversation, but we're not going to do that here today. What we want to look at today is now that we've got mobile, so we've got mobile banking, what's next? Now what? How is it? Because in itself, already, of course, mobiles have changed people's daily lives and the ability to pay on your mobile also. But in terms of inclusive growth, what are the next applications that we're going to see in this field that are going to be mobile based and going to use mobile payments as a way to transact? But what are those applications that are going to come out there? And which are those innovations that are going to drive, which are the tech trends that are going to drive those innovations most? So my question to you is, starting fresh, looking at this landscape, you're not starting fresh because you all have sort of something to do with it already one way or the other, because otherwise you wouldn't be in this session. But from where you sit right now, what do you believe that are the most important trends in those five? And we'll just take your vote now, and then we'll have a conversation, and then we'll see at the end of the conversation whether your opinion has changed or not, and then we see whether we've made some difference.
Can you clarify what you mean by important? Like profitable, impactful socially?
Most widely applicable. So one of the frameworks that we could use for this is Gartner does this hype cycle, which is similar to the more conventional way of explaining the growth or the evolution of technology. The traditional one being sort of that you've got sort of the innovators first and then the early adopters, and then there's this chasm, and then if you don't fall into it and you make it to the other side, then it goes into mainstream. So, and you can map each technology where they are, and you can say, well, for instance, we believe that blockchain might not be sort of, might still be sort of in the innovation and early adopter field and not in mainstream yet. So you can also use a different model, which is one that I find very appealing, which is the expectation hype cycle of Gartner, where they map time and expectation. So that's not actually based on the crossing of chasm is actually more based on application itself. This is purely based on perception. So that's much easier to ask, actually, and it's much more difficult for data scientists to deal with, of course. But the perception of where a technology stands is a very interesting way of looking at it. And the way this is then mapped is that when a new technology launches, immediately the expectation, assuming that it is something that people find appealing, the expectation goes sky high until it reaches the peak of inflated expectation, as it's called. So then the expectation is much higher than the actual ability of the technology to deliver, and that's when you get dissolution. So then you end up in the trough of dissolution. So a new technology that everybody was speaking about last year, you don't hear anything about it anymore this year. How did that happen? The deception is there and everybody's expectation has sort of sunken. But then quietly, in the background, the entrepreneurs are still working on it and the innovation is still happening. It's starting to mass and then it's really starting to be applied. And an interesting example, for instance, is the driverless cars that companies like Google and car companies, car manufacturers are experimenting with. At one point you heard so much about it that everybody thought they would be driving, or they wouldn't be driving, they wouldn't be sort of in one next year, which of course was a bit too quick. And so that is a clear example of where there was a hype of expectation and then a trough of dissolution. So my question to you now, and I would like your thoughts on that, is where do you think, not where do you think it sits, but what do you think will be, in terms of the growth in the next 5 years and their importance to changing the way inclusive growth in Africa is going to deliver and changing people's daily lives, which of these technologies do you think will be the most relevant, most important, most, what do you expect of them?
Africa is quite big, so either the things is really dependent if you have internet, right? So for the continent, it's quite a big question. If you specific regions.
So this is mobile first continent, so everybody has internet, potentially.
Yeah.
SIM card is connected to internet. So for me, Internet of Things in Africa is different. It's not your fridge talking to the retail store ordering milk, but it's there. It's M-Kopa, it's Internet of Things. It's a little SIM card that speaks to internet, speaks to home base, phones home, and tells sort of. Yep.
When we talk about what's going to be next in Africa, when I look at all of that, we're using that as a company, but the big thing that I would say would be the big data. But you can do big data without cloud computing, so those two have to go hand in hand.
Yes.
When I think about it.
Yeah. So the convergence of these is where the real interesting stuff is happening. So So you will find it difficult to vote for one. Is that what you're saying?
You can't have big data without cloud computing, and cloud computing won't happen if big data is not there. So big data is the next big thing in the chain of mobile technology, because that's where you're going to be able to provide new services up from, you know, just the exchange of money.
Yeah.
And to do that, because most mobile phones are using the internet, it has to be on a cloud.
Mm.
And so big data and cloud computing have to go hand in hand. Cloud computing comes in first, I think, but big data will be the big thing.
Okay, what I mean with cloud computing is more of the enabling backend things. So it's how software as a service becomes more universally applicable. So that is not the cloud of connected devices, but it's specifically using software as a service.
Do you want us to consider certain barriers as well that interact between these sort of literacy levels, for example? So obviously that's a big inhibitor for some people who might want to use mobile devices.
No, we don't want to hear bad news.
None of that, though.
No.
We put reality to one side.
We're just going to talk about opportunity.
Okay.
But in the course of talking about opportunity, we would like to hear what you think will be the bigger opportunity and what will be the lesser. And then things like capacity and infrastructure and all those things that are typically top of mind when you talk about Africa might come into play, but I really want to shift the conversation from not looking at gaps and problems, but looking at opportunities and new developments that might sort of change the picture right here. So please, if you want to play the role of the devil's advocate and throw in some reality every now and then, but we want to dream a bit. Okay. Yes? On demand can be anything that is available on demand. Service and typically it's referred to as the Uber of everything and pizza delivery and all that kind of stuff, but it is can be a bit more wider.
I think blockchain is interesting in the sense of Bitcoin, with kind of the corruption that we see, people getting tired of being cheated, and also in Kenya alone, all the different banks having challenges with. I think the challenge is explaining it.
Yes, so it's a bit early on the curve. So can I just ask you to raise hands? I'm going to do it anyway, although your convergence argument is very valid. I'm going to try it anyway. With your just say, who in this room believes that out of these five, big data is going to be the most important one?
Raise your hands high.
So okay, raise high so that Elizabeth can do the count.
We've got 12, not counting panelists who already voted.
Okay. No, we're not counting the panelists as well. I want you guys to also explain them. Yeah. Okay, next one, blockchain.
Three.
Okay. On demand.
You can't go twice.
I think it's already, it's okay, we don't have to be second. I think this gives a good idea of where we stand, and we'll do sort of another temperature gauge at the end of the session. Now, thank you also for explaining why you believe that. So for instance, your blockchain or your convergence, thank you for contributing that, and your reality check, very important. I don't want to ignore it. What I want to ask each of our panelists now is to explain their vote. And what do you see as the most important of these technology trends? And to also explain what it means to you in your daily work. What is the exciting stuff that you see happening there? And then if you want to, please also touch on the convergence question and on the reality check question. What are the things that are in your focus?
So possibly we can start by saying, you know, of course, we all know that Kenya has been dubbed as a Silicon Valley, there's no doubt. But then what we're seeing right now is a lot of these innovation spaces like the IHAT and all, you know, that started at a very good momentum. The question has been, you you know, what are the innovations that are coming out of that. And I think for me, you know, where I'm sitting right now is looking at that whole ecosystem and seeing what are some of those innovations that come out of there, you know, to create youth employment. And just recently, I was reading a report by Rockefeller on digital jobs, which pretty much says, you know, of course, the youth is basically where it's going to be a game changer. And my goal is pretty much on the big data side as well. But I don't think big data is going to stand on its own. I still believe that there's going to be a lot of strengthening of this ecosystem from the side of where these innovations are starting to be built, which is to the likes of the iHubs, to the likes of these innovation spaces. What is the support system there? Are we actually doing enough, if we'll call it market research, to basically find the opportunities that are actually going to come out of our data? So I still don't believe we are there yet, because we're seeing a lot of these startups in the distribution sector you know, coming up with so much data in the fintech space as well. But really, no one knows what to do with that data.
So can you name three that you see that you see have huge potential? You don't have to name them, but types of applications.
Yeah, so I would say one is in the FMCG distribution, whereby they're collecting a lot of data with small retailers. And they have empowered the small retailers, I would call them kiosk owners or mamamboggers, with advice where they collect data about them, and they actually take retail stock as well as orders, and then they do delivery as well. But then also they have encompassed that with the logistics aspect, operational aspect, and sorting out. Basically, they're investing in the whole value chain, which for me is quite interesting, because...
And do you see the brands, the consumer goods companies also buying that data?
Yes. But now, the question has always been, especially for these guys, you know, they don't have capacity to help them internally, to look at the data.
But the brands don't. The brands don't have the capacity, or the startups?
The startups, yeah. They don't have capacity. And also just to use that data to understand the consumer behavior. The second one I will say is in the space of deliveries as well, and they are doing, and that basically that's where the convergence comes in, on demand and big data. And they are also doing deliveries to their retail shops, but they are also providing them with a merchant solution to manage their inventory and collect as much data as possible. And I will say the third one is in fintech space. And again, still combining the on-demand and big data and blockchain somehow, which is peer-to-peer lending. And they are lending to small traders and encompassing that with understanding the data and collecting as much data sets to pretty much make the right credit score model. So I don't know if I've answered the question.
Yeah.
For me, I would just say, you know, big data is going to be big, but then the question has always been, what are we doing with regards to the support systems with the innovations of these startups and the likes that I have mentioned to help them to move to the next stage, scale their data, and also get internal capacity to help them to understand that data. And also there's the issue of demand and supply. So, you know, we're talking about, when we talk about inclusive growth, is we want to create employment with getting as many youth to sit and crunch this data. But let's not forget, we see youth are not trained. They don't have skills to actually interpret that data. The second thing is the youth actually, you know, they pretty much have no, for lack of a better word, they don't have money or support or investment. And that's why, you know, for people sitting in this room, is your investors, how can you maximize and build that capacity and training? People like EPSA are already doing that, but in my view, that's not enough. So the incubation spaces, how can they also maximize that?
Yeah. Well, I would like to give that back to you. As soon as the people that are building the ecosystem enable sort of that those startups become really sort of attractive for investment and investment ready, the investors will invest.
Sorry, just say that again.
So if you're saying investors should do more of this or that, and you're pointing to other people in the room who should be doing things, and I'm saying the ecosystem and the people around the startups should join forces and make sure those startups are investment ready,
sure.
And then the investments will come.
Absolutely. It's a demand supply gap.
It's a demand supply gap, and I think the various ways to fill that, and we can talk about it as we continue this discussion.
Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, any observations from the audience on Hilda's contribution? Anybody who disagrees or has questions or observations? Yeah.
I just wanted to say that big data is being used. If you look at how Safaricom is using mSuari,
yeah. They're
using big data behind it.
Yeah.
There's also Credit Sour, which is picking up all this data from
different
companies and trying to say this is the rate, the going rate of credit scores for these people, and banks can come in and shop over there. So in some sense, there is something happening with big data over there. Not every part of it is utilizing it the way it's supposed to be used, but there's a big interest of it.
When you say the way it's supposed to be used, what do you mean?
Like what she was explaining. She was saying that they're doing big data, they're collecting it from the merchants and everything. But the actual intention where it can actually help that particular merchant, it's not being used to help them. That's
not causing inclusive growth, is what you're saying?
Yeah, to help them add value to their services just by utilizing the data that they're collecting to the next thing.
Yeah.
But if you look at companies like, what I'm saying is, like mSuari and all these other companies that are coming up and giving lending in certain small entrepreneurs or small unbanked people or people who have small firms, and you're going to them and saying, oh, because of how much money you're spending out of your M-Pesa, we can give you this credit. In a way, it is being used. So when I think big data is already out there, but not to the extent it needs to.
And it's not responsibly used?
Not everywhere, but it is. Like, I mean, Safaricom is doing a very good job with mSuari.
Do you think that we should introduce a code of conduct on responsible use of data?
There needs to be certain protections for the consumer. That is where it is not there yet. Because everybody's data mining, what are they going to do with that data?
Yeah.
Who has the rights to that data?
Yeah.
Am I, as a consumer, being told my data is going to be used here?
Yeah.
I think that also came up in the newspapers or somewhere like a couple of weeks ago, where they're saying there's no regulation on the data, on the credit report.
Yeah.
It's like everybody can access it. Where are you? How are we protecting the consumer on big data? I think that needs to be out there.
Okay, so we've got a reality check there. Thank you. Thank you. Yep.
I'm a big advocate for big data, and I come from a purely finance background.
Yeah.
I'm changing to this. So, you see, where data is growing, and I really believe like the data is available, and that's the biggest challenge with data. How much is available? Because, I mean, there's a lot of data. When I look at where data can take us, for example, if you look at from a finance perspective, the core system, the bill spending system, the mobile phones, I mean, with the credit, with everyone accessing credit using this kind of data. To change the whole transformation. The economies where friends come from, access credit from all angles. I remember in the bank and I feel so guilty how many long files I threw away because I have to verify how many transactions I've done. What else I could know about you and make a very informed decision. So really that changed me to say, for each transaction that is being done out there, what if we get a rating system, what if we get alternative credit scoring models that we're trying to do, where could this all take us? These are the game changers, and I really think big data is a good one.
Okay, thank you. That's a clear expression of confidence. Thank you. Okay, any more observations on the helpers? Yeah?
I have a question, and I'm not a tech person.
Yes.
But just wondering, in terms of having these companies who are collecting the data where maybe their core function is not data processing, right? Like the FMCG company, but it's sort of a byproduct of what they do. Do you think, like, where do you see the opportunity for learning how to process that companies can actually do internally? And how's that happening?
So my bias is always, you know, don't outsource, bring it in-house, but you know, I wouldn't be so quick to say that because in the first place, in my view, and what I've seen in the market is we don't even have a lot of that capacity or talent. So why not bring other people, especially at the beginning, to help to put that knowledge kind of like in-house and help the team to actually understand what they have and the value of what they have. And I believe that's the first step to do it, you know, get outside people like data scientists who have been doing this and they have knowledge to kind of like come
and same with the startups and help them to understand that and build those skills in-house. For me, the long-term goal is if you have it in-house, there's a lot of value in that, understanding the data and also scaling the business. So I will always be biased to having that skills in-house for the long term.
Anybody who would disagree with that? Yes, you disagree.
Just to support what you've been saying, but I think also the main challenge around data processing is having enough funds to do that. So bringing someone in-house to actually dedicate time to organize that information. And our fund and other impact funds are willing to put in grant funding that goes towards developing that data processing, because at the end of the day, as we're reporting to our investors, we also need to report tangible social impact data. And the only way we can have this is if the entrepreneur and the management team has the capacity to interpret what they're collecting. So outsourcing it may not necessarily be beneficial for the company. One, in developing additional solutions, because that information is important for them. And two, for the investors to get the relevant information.
Okay, thank you. So if you want to comment, you're a big data company. Would you like to add something to this?
I'm also going to wait.
Okay,
I give my perspective from a tech perspective, and probably you will like it. I think so much hype about big data. I think it's on there. I have been doing writing applications since 2006. They are old. And I think the way the banks, the mobile companies, are collecting data with a view of actually using it in the future, actually being stored for government verifications and that sort of thing. So the data is actually not there. So I think for the last 2 years is where we are actually making strides in collecting that data with a view of actually using it in the next couple of years. So you look at, for the audience, someone mentioned about ensuring. I think ensuring is sort of like, it's sort of taking off the way it should have. To me, it's like a failure because the data wasn't there.
Just 1 second. Is everybody familiar with MSWARI? Nobody likes to explain?
So I think this is the time when we're trying to collect the data in the right way and use it in the right way. So I'll probably go with on-demand services to sort of like help us collect this data and start making use of this data. So I'll basically take a step back and sort of like figure out the problem should be how do we collect this data in a good way? Use it to sort of like solve these other problems of blockchain, internet of things. I mean, that all that would exist if that data is not there. I mean, right now we're talking about scoring and all that. That data is not there. I mean, it's not there. The banks are struggling. I mean, how about? I think 3 years ago I sort of like was doing a switch, one of the banks, and just getting how long. I mean, just getting like how frequent a customer shows in a particular region is a problem, and they have that data. So I think that's a problem. So I'll switch it back and say, how do we start collecting data to make, for us to be able to sort of like start providing these services? In my business, I think we're struggling with that as well. So we're in the on-demand space, and so like we're figuring out how do we, the data is not there, so we are collecting the data and basically trying to figure out how do we use it to basically better our service, and sort of like, push back the benefits back to the consumer.
So what you're saying, the data is not there. When you compare that to the situation in the bank, aren't you saying the data might be there, but it's not accessible. You can't really use it.
The data you can use. I mean, we're seeing a lot of changes happening in the changing systems, the way they store the data, the way they use the data. There is sort of a change. But I think 2006. The best you could do is a USSD application, and sort of like the only thing you get there is a phone number. I mean, just a phone number. And 3 years later, you can sort of like now get other things, and basically things change the way you start collecting them. And the idea is like when you start doing that, how do you envision using that data? And that actually informs how you start storing that data. I mean, the companies who actually clear that data. I mean, 7 years they clear that data. Because the government actually wants you to have that data for 7 years, so you actually clear it. So I think this hype around big data, I think we take a step back and figure out how do we start collecting the right data and then use it correctly.
Okay. I just wanted to make a comment on that.
this is a company called SI Queries, siqueries.com. And fundamentally, we're trying to solve this problem because we realized that between the previous two speakers, the real challenge is that the data that's collected is not structured. So normally, data the worst is structured. And so most applications that are built by Oracle and other companies are built for structured data. The problem is that the data is not structured. So we actually built a business intelligence platform, which we just about to launch. It took that 2 years of a team working on it to start analyzing unstructured data and actually analyze it in real time. So the data that is there can be useful in a certain way, but it's just the way the applications were built to interact with it. That is the problem.
So is that a problem or an opportunity?
Well, I thought it was an opportunity. The way I see problems. You know? So I got a bunch of guys together and put in money and it's like, let's build this. Because everywhere you go in Africa, that's the data you see, it's unstructured. Right. So you can wait for it to become structured, or you can start working with structured data. I believe in very hands were too in the bush.
So I would, if I would be sitting outside of Africa and I would look at Africa, I would say actually that the lack of proper data and the unstructured nature of it is actually a huge opportunity because you don't have any legacy issues. Is that? You can just start building it from scratch in the way you really want it.
I'm going to complicate this.
Yeah, that's the whole idea.
Because I think it's not there is data, there isn't data. There can always be more data. We're in this century of every day there's more data than there were, you know, 20 years ago. So there's no longer a question of is there data. It's what kind of data and who has it. So Safaricom is a corporation. They are the monopoly phone provider here. So they have data on, I don't know, 80-90% of all the mobile phone calls made in Kenya. That's a great data set. They're using it for certain purposes. That's not to say that data couldn't also be used for a lot of other services, like last mile connections, access to financial services. If Safaricom doesn't care or isn't interested in that question, they won't use the data to answer those questions. So there's also a linkage between what questions are being asked of what data and who has it. And sometimes the people that care about inclusivity are not the people who have the data that can answer the inclusivity problems. And so something else you can see Africa as a great opportunity for is because this isn't America with this overload of data where everyone has too much data to know what to do with, here you really need data sharing opportunities. And you need to find ways of creating partnerships, MOUs, data sharing, so that if I have data and you have a question that I don't really care to answer, or maybe I don't have the capacity to answer, but I have the data, how can we work together so that you can answer that question? Maybe that means my data becomes a secondary product of whatever else I'm doing. Maybe that means that you're going to teach me about my customer base, something that I thought I knew, but often you don't actually know as well. So I think it's sort of a mixture of these, if that makes sense. You know, there is data, there might be gaps in data, but there are ways that can really be strength.
Okay, thank you.
I think just to add on that, I'll possibly go back, I don't know if it's going back or going forward, to the government. Because, you know, of course the government is doing a lot of stuff to digitize a lot of processes, public processes, and I think I will start from there because, you know, in the past, how it was, if you want to get your ID, to go through this manual process to achieve, it was crazy. But right now, I can apply for my passport online, I can renew my passport online, I can apply for my ID online, I don't need to go in the queue at the police station, and many other things, including we're seeing the e-citizen platform bringing all this digitization. So we're starting at the citizen level, already the government is working on it. I remember 4 years ago, I think it's 4 years ago, 6 years ago, when the government launched our open data platform. And Bitanga Ndemo was then the PS. And it just died when he left. And basically what we're trying to do is collect all this data and pretty much encourage the citizens to start going digital, creating digital citizens. But then when he left as a techie in the government, everything collapsed. So, you know, of course we have people like Joe Michelle right now who are doing that and bringing all those together and seeing how to bring the techies to the government to code and do hackathons and build this data. So I really say, you know, we've started that journey of collecting the data. The government is doing it. And I think the question for me is, what is big data? Because we can crowdsource, we can build this data, but all of us in this room crowdsourcing this data, bringing the techies and all these guys. But even the community doesn't understand what is big data. And the other question, especially for businesses and the startups, is what is enough data?
Okay, now we're going to stop here. This is my question.
Sorry, I was just...
So I just want to...
I think I agree, there's some data, as you said, that is structured. But when we speak about big data, are we just speaking about the money you have in your bank account and how much you draw it, how much you deposit? This, when we talk about big data, we mean this, you could be transacting in the bank, you're transacting in the M-Pesa or mobile money. But you have an 88% of your other life that is going on. You have a lot of things. There's a buying trend. How often you go to hospital, and how that whole thing is not there. So that's why I play the double advocate and say, at least that basically collecting this data and that structure.
Okay, I would like to give Fahid a chance to also add some. And then I would like to start wrapping up the big data discussion and move on to the next few topics. Unless you want to talk about something else, then we'll move on to that.
Maybe it's just a question about the big data. You gather the big data, you do the big data analysis, and now you have to do something with it. It feels like it's not necessarily an ends in itself. So it's maybe just one question about big data.
Yeah.
What does it lead to?
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Maybe that's a question, Elizabeth, you can answer.
Sure.
Or maybe actually no, I think we've had too much panel talking.
Is there anybody in the room who would want to answer that
so
question?
I saw one question.
It's a so what question.
To go on, I think Eric and Elizabeth have answered it for the most part, but I think when you ask how to use it, I think it comes from a surprising example. There's a UN, which is hardly known for its innovation. UN Data Pulse is a center created, and it's actually explicitly using big data to solve interesting problems. And they've used it a few years ago to map malaria in Kenya, for example, and you've got a very good idea of how to map the epidemiology of the malaria, track it, and that's an incredibly useful way of using very unstructured data at the time, working with guys like Safaricom and others to access that data. So it had many of the things you're talking about, and combine many of the different recipes to get something that's actually quite effective. So I think it can be done. It just depends the vision that you have and what you want to do.
There's also another company that's done it for Ebola, I think, in
West Africa.
Yeah.
YouTube.
Excellent. Thank you. The so what question?
Mine is not a question. It's just a...
No, we want to answer to the so what question from you. So that was where we are. So the question of the interest is, okay, we've done the data, we've structured it, we've done the analysis. Now, how is it going to benefit the people? Can we have more examples of that? That is my question to you.
So I think that data that can benefit people has to be timely, it has to be accurate, and it requires enhanced capacities to continuously process data. And I think that that's the graph, which presents us an opportunity for both of us in the future.
Thank you.
We were speaking to Safaricom,
yeah,
and we were trying to do a pilot project with them,
yeah,
on usage of mobiles in different parts of the country,
yeah,
and understanding the usage patterns so that we can target our products to those particular markets,
yeah,
or to those particular areas.
Okay.
So yes, that's one example.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. More examples? Yep.
A very good example, I think, in South Asia, in South African countries, is the level of our impact. For example, if less than 10% of our population, about 135 million, 50, about actually population counts, going back to Uganda, 5 million, less than 4 million Ugandans have a bank account, and over 15 million people are using mobile money. And we can't lend the 15 million people, they can't borrow, they can't access credit. Why are we using this startup? This startup can help us to do so many things, make very informed decisions, using the levels of transaction, the number of calls they make,
it's a credit score,
and a lot of opportunities.
Okay, thank you. Any more examples, or shall we move on? Yep.
Yeah, I'll give one final example before you contribute. So one of my investee companies is Encompa Solar. And just looking, comparing Encompa to other organizations that develop solutions just to capture data, and that targets a sort of bottom of the pyramid segment. there's a lot of information that they come across and deliberately and actively collect. And this is information that they use to now go ahead and develop additional solutions, right? So this is information that, information data is king. So if you understand how it can benefit you as an organization, so they've done that to develop other add-on products for the existing solar home systems. So that's something I think any entrepreneur that's looking towards targeting these EOPs, they can collect that data. And we have big institutions that are willing to tap into the bottom of the pyramid market, but they just don't have the capacity to do so. They'd rather focus on the sort of easy to target corporates, but they're happy to get to that level. So if you're able to provide that information, then it's definitely well competitive by everyone. So if you work towards just having that, you know, sort of your strong selling point.
Okay, one last
one.
Yes, we can use data. So.
Yeah.
Question from my side, we're going to program increasing access to water sanitation for the poor, and we are curious what can data do or mobile do to increase access to sanitation for the poor, or and see two things can use the data for better targeting, also use as a revenue stream for your kids model. So so we look into innovations we can support that will help that. So let's hope to get inspiration.
Okay, so please all innovations, please.
Yeah.
Please support us. Yeah.
Okay,
great, thank you. So I think we've explored the topic of big data pretty thoroughly, and also looking at the time, I would want to spend some more time also on the other ones, so that those of you who are interested and voted for the other ones are not too disappointed and starting to sort of unplug from this session. So please, if you're all still here and are still sort of with us, I think sort of by popular vote, we're now going to the on-demand. That's maybe it's good actually if we just take a break, because everybody agrees that big data is important. Mm-hmm. Nobody agrees that cloud computing is going to be a really sort of game changer. So maybe can you enlighten us on how that's going to be a game changer? And then we'll go to the more comfortable territory of on demand, which is where everybody agrees.
Uncomfortable territory.
Okay.
So I guess the reason I asked the question is I don't know how big data on its own, without the other components, can really affect change. I think we're a pretty good example of that. At Nomanini, we provide a purpose-built point-of-sale terminal for informal markets. So we are Internet of Things. We benefit from the fact that there's mobile internet all around us, we're able to gather that data and provide transactions. We process all that data on cloud-based services, because in the retail space, you have a blip in the morning, and in the afternoon, you have a ton of data thrown your way, and then nothing. And there's no way we can afford to run those servers on our own. So we are enabled by the on-demand aspect of cloud computing to do all these things. And we do crunch this big data. We're able to see exactly when a merchant is going to run out of float and actually proactively send a field rep out there to assist them. We can see when a battery is wearing down. We can credit score our merchants. We can, in fact, and it's a bit startling actually, with we're able to track them, where they're vending from, how often they're vending, what the consistency of their vending hours are, where they go home at night, where they go to church on Sundays. So there's this wealth of data that we have about these really pivotal actors in the community. So I think data is definitely hugely important, but without the other stuff, I can't imagine how we would be able to exploit that and bring positive benefit to people.
On cloud computing, you contribute, anybody want to contribute, support cloud computing as a game changer?
I think so.
Yep.
I mean, our companies, we do pay-as-you-go technology for renewable energy and agriculture, and everything we have, all of this data, everything is in the cloud, and that's how we run our business. If we didn't have it, we couldn't do it.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Any other companies here that are in the cloud and come? Yeah, you're also?
Yeah, we're in the cloud, and Internet of Things is almost impossible without cloud computing.
Yeah.
Because how are you going to connect all the devices, and how are you going to be able to talk to each other? So cloud computing is the main factor actually for almost anything that's going to be happening in the future.
And anything,
you ask me, but they all
They're all related to it.
Are you going to a cloud computer?
Yeah. Because I didn't want to go to twice. I didn't want to go to twice.
You want to go
to
five.
So just one thing on that. So when you think about cloud computing in Africa, to what extent is it particular, and are there certain things you need to do in Africa that are different from the rest of the world?
When I think of cloud computing, this is what it is. Because of intermittent internet and everything, if you are to have your own servers, for one thing, it's very expensive. Cloud computing is much cheaper to maintain. Some of the licensing and the securities we need to have in servers, we really don't have even the technology to put it on there. But if you go to the cloud, you can find companies that are offering cloud computing that they already have these services out there. So you don't really have to start inventing the wheel, you can just ride on it. So I think cloud computing is very, very important for Africa. We don't have to build it ourselves. We can just go to Google. Google has it. I think it's very important. And I think it will help accelerate most of the development and the ecosystem that we want to build.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody disagree or add to that or observations on that? Yes, please.
I think there are like confusing questions that you posed us between five topics because some are very consumer facing and some are tools that businesses use.
Okay.
And so like how do you pick what's most important? Are you talking about the tools that businesses need? Well, they need cloud computing, they need big data. Blockchain is a great resource for them to like use for transparency. But consumers don't care about blockchain. It's super confusing. Consumers care about on-demand. So if you're talking about what's big for consumers, consumers don't care about cloud computing right now. Businesses need cloud computing to build a business that makes sense to consumers. So the question is, like, what is the question? What's big for businesses? What's big for consumers? Like, what do technology companies need?
The whole idea is to create confusion, and we'll vote again, and we see whether cloud computing eventually becomes the winner, right? So this is really great.
But again,
there's one data point for...
what is the question?
It's most important to who?
You. No, you're not talking for me.
Or me being an individual as a business.
I don't know.
For you as a corporate.
I need cloud computing, and I need big data to run my business.
Uh-huh.
But I am an on-demand business.
That's it.
Right? But I'm an on-demand business that doesn't have any data about addressing, doesn't have any data from the government about whether or not my riders are actually
never
been to prison. There's no government data. I need data. I need cloud computing. But I'm an on-demand business. My customers want
them.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, the title of the session is inclusive digital.
Yes.
Which, I mean, to your point, that's not a corporation or a company situation. Inclusive truly means the consumer.
Okay, so wait, that's a valid point, but I want to address that point first, if you don't mind. Mm-hmm. So the question of why this confusing question is because of the five trends that are there, each of them will go through their own stages of development. Some are more advanced than the others. And I think it's safe to say that sort of Internet of Things is a bit more advanced in Africa than blockchain is. So each of them looked at individually, we can see what the state of affairs is in those trends. Do you agree with me on that?
I agree that depending on how you pose the question, all five of those could
possibly... No, I'm not talking about the question. I'm talking about whether it's useful to look at those
They're all trends.
Yes, they're all trends. They're all trends, and trends in isolation, you can look at them.
But
they're relevant for businesses in convergence. I agree with you. But in isolation, you can look at them and see where they are.
Exactly. So you can see them as trends on its own. But when you're saying, when you want to apply them to yourself, then the manifestations are different.
So the discussion here doesn't connect. We jump from how Mshwari is using data to whether or not we need data to whether or not we have data. So, do the customers care about data? I mean, it's we are all over the place.
We're all over the place. It's stretching.
And, everyone can depend on whether you're talking about consumers or businesses or, companies or government.
Yeah, okay. So, I hear what you're saying, and I understand that convergence is crucial in where each of those trends work together is where it really starts to make a difference in people's lives. And that's where I want to also address your questions. Why are we talking about inclusive innovation, because it's not innovation for innovation's sake, but it's actually the question that we started talking about was, now that we know that there's mobile and that there is mobile payments and that's everywhere, now so what? What's next? How is it going to change people's lives? And that is what we mean with inclusive innovation. So that's the underlying theme of the conversation here. And what I would want to distill out of the conversation that we've had so far in isolation about big data is that everybody agrees that there is a lot of unstructured data still out there, and it's not accessible from the government's point of view, which was the point that Hilda made. And so now when we talk about sort of where is big data in Africa, it actually needs still a lot of investment and a lot of effort put into ensuring that the data gathering and the data analysis and the use of the data gets much better. But that's also where the opportunity lies. So that's why I think when I ask the question, where do you think, where are the trends that are going to be the most important, which was the fundamental question, the answer that big data was one of the most important actually is also justified by the fact that we're already 3/4 into the session and everybody keeps coming back. So on-demand, definitely very important, and especially if you run a business in that area. I want to move on to that now. But I think looking at those trends in isolation also and seeing what are the opportunities and what are the pitfalls is something that is useful to look at it, because there's different experiences from different angles and different types of companies that use it. In the way also that Fahid highlighted, that big data and Internet of Things and cloud computing are all very relevant for his business.
I think just to add on that, possibly just for the sake of Malaika, I want to turn the question a bit, just from the way I understood it, just a bit. So inclusive growth and providing that opportunity, when I started this discussion, I said, I believe the opportunity is going to be for youth employment.
Yeah.
And youth employment definitely is part of this inclusive growth and all that. But again, the way I drill it down, this is just from my own understanding, is then youth employment is definitely going to be a game changer. Anything that technology is doing to promote more youth and create opportunities for them, fantastic. It's going to grow the inclusive growth. But then the question is, drilling it down, is then what are those opportunities and what are those areas to then bring that inclusive growth? Are they coming to crunch data? Are they coming to logistics? Are they coming to? So I think drilling it down, the question we are, in my understanding, we are answering now, is at the point where by now we are asking ourselves, what are those opportunities from an example or from a life experience perspective to then bring that inclusive growth?
The iCloud, right? Yeah. That's what consumers are using. Now, from a business perspective, it's totally different. We're all using, like, you know, when our servers crash, that's a disaster, right?
Yeah.
But when you think about building a company today, and you think about, like, where can I hit sales really, really fast? Are you going to be like, ooh, I'm going to build another cloud computing company in Kenya? Like, yeah, there are one or two, and, like, they're growing. But no, you're like, hey, I'm going to do food delivery, because consumers will buy that today, right now. You look at where the West is going, everything is on demand. You bring that to Africa.
So how is it different today?
I think the interesting part of on-demand is the last mile of delivery particularly.
Yeah.
And a lot of innovation like What Three Words, for example, which are being used as apps to help target that last mile. So
yeah.
I think really for me, on-demand is how you connect those two different parts of how you provide the food, for example, the one side, but how you can deliver it to places that are incredibly difficult to find.
Yeah.
So that's one big opportunity. Right now, I think it's just starting, and there's a lot of work to be done to integrate it.
Okay.
With an on-demand service, you have to be really flexible and respond to your customer.
Yeah.
Because whether you realize that for what you're doing, you are missing information that you could call data, but we won't go back there. Or if you realize that the interests or needs are shifting in a different way, then you need to be able to adjust to that. And so I think, you know, we're still a very small company, but the reason that we are known and that we're growing is because we don't kind of force our customers to only get certain services from us. If they start talking about the Pope's visit and where the roads are closed, we're not going to be like, no, guys, we're talking about traffic, not the Pope, you know, please don't share pictures of the Pope. No, you know, you have to kind of, and obviously with crowdsourcing, you're particularly flexible, and so that might not be entirely applicable to a more sort of linear company, but I still think this idea of flexibility is how you go from being a flash in the pan, on-demand company, to a lasting one that can grow with your consumer base and even expand beyond urban areas where obviously that's a lot easier.
Any other examples of on-demand?
I guess I actually have a question. I'm working with a company who want to provide mobile legal services to the masses. So you've heard of mHealth, Safaricom. So if we're not partnering with a big company like Safaricom, like an Airtel, or we're not getting out there in the media, how are you reaching your consumers? Because I think there are a lot of great ideas out there. I think a mobile legal app is great to provide legal services for the masses that is affordable and keep things out of the court because we have a corrupt court system. But now how do you actually gain momentum and create that momentum and really hit your target market?
So I told you this investment company called 4A, which is an on-demand service. Everybody wants to know, right? These guys have never advertised in Ghana. But the reason they think it's working is that everybody has a laundry problem. And they just figure out to use app as a way to organize it. So you want this shirt tonight, you will see, put it in an app, we'll pick it up, give us a phone, we'll pick it up, and we'll drop it out. And I think that that is the best way that the businesses of the 21st century are going to creep on you and you know it. I mean, Uber ever advertised to you, but you needed a taxi, so you looked for something and you got Uber. So I really think that the way in which companies manifest themselves in the on-demand world is going to be very different. And the next is you got to find something people want and then you use app to organize it. And then it goes back.
I live in Kenya, I've been here for 3 years, I've not heard of the traffic service. I mean, why have I not heard of that? So, you know, so that's what I mean, like me as, starting off with a great idea, Montage, it's a great idea, target market, you have a niche. Now you're trying to trickle down into other consumers. I lived here for 3 years, I would love to know what you're doing. Why do I not know about it? So that's the thing is, you have this on demand, now make it that demand.
My answer directly would be that we are a much more Kenyan community than an expat community. Our name is from Shang, and so definitely there are certain demographics that know us very well, and there are other demographics that haven't heard of it. Obviously, crossover mission is terrible. Don't ask me anything. Shang, if you don't know, is the Nairobi-specific sort of slang that is English and Swahili mixed together, which is very youth-oriented and changes rapidly, so it's very hard to kind of learn. But also, you know, going up along with solving the problem, we grew almost entirely from word of mouth. And so you didn't know about us until today, and now you know, and the next time your friend is complaining about a 3-hour traffic jam, you'll probably be like, oh, I just heard about this app that actually gives you real-time traffic information. You should try it. And so it's more about not just having the problem don't work for you, you're going to forget us. But if we do work for you, we'll be the thing you tell the next 5 people that complain about traffic. And that's, you know, I mean, it's not necessarily the fastest way to grow, and that's certainly something we're thinking about when we try to hop out of Kenya, you know, even if it's just Tanzania or Nigeria. So there are other issues that I think you're making a good point about, and that's, from our side, it's finding that local sort of structure and building on that, because we're a community, so we that for you, it might be finding people that get screwed over the most by lawyers and going to them first. You know, whether it's being an ambulance chaser and going to traffic accidents, because that's definitely one way to prevent law corruption. I'll stop there.
Any more feedback on that question?
On which question?
On the question of how do you mobilize that on demand, the demand from.
That wasn't my feedback.
Okay.
Just one question to the on demand guys.
Can you hear that? There's a solution here. Can we just?
I didn't necessarily have a solution. I just wanted to encourage those that are doing the on demand. Another way to grow your business is also focusing on the service side. So when you have someone doing a delivery, and they come, they're late, they're rude, that's a way to also kill your on-demand business. So I think there's a lot focused on the data, the big map pool, but if your delivery people are not as good as what you're presenting to the audience, like I use Cindy every day, and I spread it to, you know, everyone that I know, but now when the drivers are coming late, they're a bit rude, they're like not coming to the right place, that's also a difficulty. And I find with on-demand, the focus is on the delivery, but not from the service perspective. And so, like what you were mentioning, not knowing about her service, you're probably not in the car all the time. Maybe you're in a taxi. Maybe, did you start with Matatus? People in Matatus?
Yes,
so you're not in a Matatu probably. So it's just also knowing who your audience is. So if your audience is a business person, time is important. That's the reason why I'm not driving and delivering it myself. So focusing on that server side, I think, is also key for on demand.
So I just have a question on the on-demand, in terms of this focus on inclusive growth.
Yeah.
I'm curious because there are so many new apps that come up every day and to provide on-demand services, but I feel like they're focusing on sort of Nairobi people problems, right? So, and if you're in Nairobi, you're sort of already included in the economy, right?
Yeah.
So and they're probably, because it's harder, far fewer services, on-demand services for people who are not included in the economy at all. And we talked about financial inclusion,
so
and that's an obvious one. So, but I mean, laundry services and traffic and legal services is not really getting to the core of the inclusivity question, right?
Yeah.
Malika,
do you want to say something about it?
Just to add, because I know you're going to answer this question as well, which I need to ask you guys who are in the on-demand space, is the distribution network, you know, and the scaling aspect for me has always been a question that has sparked my mind for so many times is, like, especially for you guys with Sendly, how are you thinking about completing that value chain, you know, and acquiring the customers? The cost of it is very high. Of course, in this case, your customer being, or rather your partner being the drivers. And also building that model in a sense that do you eventually plan to own the bikes? Do you eventually, so how do you plan to close that cycle, and even if it's with partners, in the scalability aspect of things?
Talking about how where you might start in Nairobi, because that's where you could prove out a model, where that's where you have paid customers. But ideally, which I can talk about this, the long-term solution for, you know, going rural.
I guess I'm answering your question. One is, I think the problem is on the assets. At this point, the problem is on the assets. The assets are already there. I mean, as we speak, you have a couple of trucks moving from Mombasa to Nairobi, half of them are empty. What's the point of having those trucks coming all this way and half of them are empty? You could consolidate that until they share that asset and actually achieve maximum utilization and bring down the cost. So the idea is to pilot in Nairobi and make sure that we completely made Nairobi. But the long-term vision is, how do we take products back to the rural areas in a cost-effective way? And how do we bring back things from the rural back to the city? So you're a farmer, you have your produce, you may be somewhere. There's a truck leaving Nairobi today with farm produce. The truck will go back empty, but then there's a hardware company that is selling cement, iron sheets, that needs those iron sheets back. So how do we basically make that happen? The existing assets, not necessarily investing in assets.
Okay, can I just add one more thing to that? So I think actually the overall answer also to that question of, is it just Nairobi problems that we're going to solve in on-demand? Or is it just first world problems that we're going to resolve in Africa? I think that the way to look at it is actually that compared to the first world, where it is very much out of convenience, that you will see those convenience things happening here as well. Mm-hmm. But actually the bigger nut to crack is the logistics, as you're explaining.
Yeah.
And the lack of coordination in a lot of logistics. And so when you talk about the Uber for this or the Uber for that for Africa, you'll talk about actually resolving all of those logistical questions that are still huge. And so the Uber for delivery is one thing when it comes to Nairobi, but for the bigger transportation system, it's still huge nut to crack.
I mean, I have to sort of do it in Nairobi first. So we do it in Nairobi so that at least I get your capital. Otherwise, if I tell you that I'm not going to do this intercity, that's sort of like without really proving the model, you probably won't give me from my investment perspective, you won't give me your mind. So sort of like, how do we look at proving your model and sort of like how scaling it to basically push the benefits of the
continent? There's another thing too. We're all thinking of Uber as a service for riders. I would say talk to your Uber drivers. Obviously, I'm a transportation person. I do this a lot. But Uber gives drivers the opportunity to make 4 or 5 times more than they normally make during the day. Drivers in Nairobi have trouble reaching customers. So you have to look at these as a full thing. Laundry might seem like, oh, now my laundry's getting done. But the woman washing my laundry has a job that she wouldn't have, because how am I going to find a woman to wash my laundry? I just moved to Ghana, right? So, you know, there's, the inclusive economy isn't just about who the main customer is, who's the entire customer. You know, maybe we're giving directions so that you're not sitting in traffic for 2 hours, but reducing traffic reduces emissions, it reduces waste in the economy. You know,
these are sort of trickle-down benefits or even not there, you know, it's a holistic thing. So I think that's the trick here, that a lot of innovations are inclusive just because they're expanding the economy.
Okay. So if you're all in agreement, I think we've touched on demands now pretty thoroughly. Not as thoroughly as we did on big data, but that's because that was top of our mind. Now we're going to move as one last topic before we finish off this session to blockchain. And I know you're dying to say something about that.
Oh, well, before I'm going to make a blockchain point, but just one example. So we have what we call hey boys and hey girls, and they actually come and pick up the laundry. And these are college people that were trained to make Australia come to pay for their education. So it doesn't actually the cycle that it works. So anyway, let me get to the question of blockchain. So one of the things I've been sitting on my mind as an investor and as a technologist, so this is my nightmare now, is that I really think that we have a problem now with the mobile operators, and a lot of my friends and so on, and I'm making an issue of too. But the fact that somebody is rent seeking and yet it's very obstructious in the market, I think it's ready for disruption. So when you take Google money, I think there's going to be a next level of disruption. This is what I want to invest in next. How can I transfer to you without paying 70% to, I don't want to use names, who is just there, right? And then that person is even more obstructionist about the whole transaction. And I think that's where blockchain technology comes in. It's going to start going around a rent seeking idea and begin to provide innovation that will create the next disruption. So another example, for example, is peer-to-peer lending. So my phone has Wi-Fi, I often ask Wi-Fi, why can't we transfer to Twitter directly? Why do you have to go to someone who has good thing and get 70%? Right. So those are the kinds of ideas that I think are the next big thing that will happen in fintech, connecting blockchain.
Okay. Anybody to comment on that?
I think we're missing one thing in this discussion, and a great example of it is blockchain.
Yeah.
And when we're talking about inclusive technologies, I'm really surprised we're not looking at who's the product and who's the user in these cases. And a really great touch point on blockchain is that anyone can be involved once they have some device like this or a little larger, right?
Yeah.
Where every single of the, all the ones below blockchain, so on demand is when I choose it, I get it. Cloud computing, same thing, even if we're just syncing files. Internet of things, maybe I'm looking at my soil from a satellite image, something like that, I'm not sure. But big data, all of a sudden I'm the product, and almost the entire point of big data is to consolidate power, right, through information for these companies we're talking about. Now, Safaricom is trying to do something great with it with Mshwari, but they're not being so transparent. Like, they could say, oh, wow, it turns out you're in the highest risk demographic, so your insurance is higher. And they're saying that to every single person. So I'm not entirely sure big data is super inclusive from the start, whereas each of the other ones let the little guy play at the table with the big ones. Especially blockchain, right, where we can suggest a code change.
Okay, thank you. It's very acceptable. Any more questions?
I think what you just mentioned with the transferring money without cash out, that's a really good solution for inclusiveness. Because in the rural areas, you don't have the person, you don't have the network. So we, for Kiosk model, we're looking how to carry distributed. That cash in, cash out is actually bomb. So please develop.
It's not already the finance thing, so you develop.
Come on, you. Who's
going to own
up?
Who's
going to
develop? Who's going to own up?
Be confident.
I'm ready to write a check.
Okay, so one thing I would like to add.
I'm sure you write a check too, right?
And actually, I would write a check for any blockchain technology that is inclusive. And I think that we are underestimating how big it is at the moment. And what is really exciting about blockchain, I think, is that it is, because it is a distributed ledger, there's no single owner. And that means that you can actually, now I'm not talking about Bitcoin, which is what you might
want to say. I'm not talking about it, don't worry.
But let me finish my sentence. So I'm not talking about Bitcoin, just to make that sure, because Bitcoin itself is just an application, and I think you can draw a parallel with internet browsers. So the way internet browsers work in developed countries, now Africa is a mobile first country, but in developed countries people use something that is called, more old-fashioned way of accessing the internet, and they use internet browsers for that. And Netscape was the first, but nobody knows about Netscape. The young generation was Netscape. So in a few years, we won't know what Bitcoin was anymore, but blockchain, everybody will know. And that kind of technology that will enable distributed ledgers to be available and accessible for information, that is where everybody can hold the key as they want to use it, for software, whether it's for medical records, for land registries, for all of the stuff where big data is going to change the way Africa works for the lower income segments. I think blockchain is going to be the most disruptive technology. And we just only, it's very much on the left of that column, so we're not even at the height of the inflation expectations. But once it's gone through the resolution, I think it's going to be huge. Please.
So to turn this into an opportunity,
yeah.
That if you're old enough to remember the web, like the whole conversation that started in the 90s and the early noughties and what's happening now, I think you just expressed the same thing about blockchain. Yeah, we're talking about technology that was, and we're talking about it in chronological terms. Actually, that very distinction you made between Bitcoin and Netscape is something that we need to import. So I guess my question, in an opportunity way, is how do we ensure that the use of blockchain continues to be inclusive as opposed to the way that it's a browser to the web, which was necessarily exclusive and actually continues to be the case today. So that's my opportunity question.
Yeah.
So my answer is that the inclusivity is how it disrupts the existing market. So for example, it's a company I'm talking to and it's very confidential. This guy is using blockchain technology to disrupt advertising. So the way opt-in advertising or advertising was going to change entirely. And as well as in San Francisco, I spent some time with him. And this is going to be really great. So I could see how blockchain technology, I mean, he made me just realize that point that blockchain technology is really going to disrupt a lot of existing markets. Because everything becomes decentralized. And that's very powerful.
I think it's going to disrupt it on both sides. So back to your point of who's going to be the user and where does it come from. And I think what you'll see with blockchain is that the way that the blocks in the blockchain are generated are actually going to be much, the threshold to actually be part of that is going to be much, much lower.
Yes.
And at the end use side, so the applications that I use for reducing the cost of healthcare data, or the use, because it's just database technology. It sounds very complex, but it's actually quite simple. It's a different way of making data accessible. That's what it is. And the applications that it can have by making things smarter and the use of data smarter will also lower the threshold for people in Africa to use it, is my expectation.
Totally agree.
That's a quick response to that. It's just that HTML thing. So sorry, the whole kind of hyperlinking thing, yeah? That's how the conversation of hyperlinking started. And then they removed the ability of hyperlinks to kind of mutually link across two different areas. That was the issue. So this, sorry, it sounds really like uber nerdy, and I'm really sorry. I'm fully aware of that, and I'm a proper nerd. So. But like this is really important, because this is about how we ensure its inclusivity in the design of the tech from the start.
Yeah.
And like what I'm worried about is going, it will be cool and it will be like really open, because it won't be. Because like you just said, like Google will just invest a trunk ton of stuff in that.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
We're cool, right? So that's
no,
the thing about how
we have to avoid the net dilution. I'm talking with you there.
But I'm just thinking, it depends where you pitch your tent or where you pitch your bat in blockchain, particularly because I think, like you said, the gatekeepers could be incredibly important. So if you access the data, and data becomes even more important than it is now because blockchain is important, it has to get access to it.
Yeah.
And financial data, for example, you're talking about, it'd be great to touch two phones together. You still need to be able to collaborate with people that have that power in the first place. And if they're not willing to share it, blockchain doesn't exist. And it's the same with health data and other areas. You can figure out how you can motivate invested interests to basically want, so what's in it for them? How can you make sure they get something from
it? So here's my question to you. Where it is interesting for Africa, it's actually the vested interests are much, much less present. Because you're talking about infrastructure that's not there yet. So you're not disrupting an existing infrastructure. Like for land registry in Africa, most countries don't have it. So there's no vested interest like there is in developed countries to switch from an existing way of registering land to a new way.
Sure.
There is, you're switching from zero to
so
a
I
way
of registering. Where you pitch your tent. So I mean, I think
Safari
common these guys, it's much more difficult.
Oh, of course.
Established environment.
Yeah.
And I think in some sort of banking sector, again, it's more difficult because of an established environment. But areas where there's nothing there, of course.
So I know that you dislike the way I asked the question, can you choose between one of these five? But I appreciated your participation. And I hope that sort of, despite comments of this being all over the place, I hope that at the end of all of this, it has been useful for you to have sort of these conversations around these five friends.